In this video, we will show you two uniqueness theorems of electrostatics. The first one will prove that if we find a solution to the Laplace equation, this will be the only solution. It is unique. The second uniqueness theorem is concerned with the Poisson equation and tells us under which circumstances the electric field is unique. The first uniqueness theorem states that the solution to Laplace's equation, which is the electrostatic field phi, is uniquely determined in a certain volume V if we specify the value of phi at the boundary of V. The Laplace equation describes a region without any charge density. Any charges that affect the shape of our potential are somewhere else, outside the region, and they determine the value of phi at the boundary. So let's start by assuming that we have two solutions to this Laplace equation, phi 1 and phi 2. They obey the same boundary conditions, so phi 1 at the boundary is equal to phi 2 at the boundary. Now we define a new potential, phi 3, as the difference between phi 1 and phi 2. Therefore, also phi 3 fulfills the Laplace equation simply because phi 1 and phi 2 fulfill it separately. Here comes the important point. Since phi 1 and phi 2 obey the same boundary conditions, phi 3 at the boundary is zero everywhere. A nice fact about the Laplace equation is that it is guaranteed that the smallest value of its solution and its largest value have to lie on the boundary, not somewhere within. But phi 3 is zero on the boundary. So if 0 is its largest value and at the same time its smallest value, then phi 3 is itself 0 everywhere. And this means that phi 1 and phi 2 are in fact exactly the same functions, and the solution to the Laplace equation is unique. For the next uniqueness theorem, we're looking at the electric field. Now, since there is no electric field without a charge, we fill the whole region with some charge density. The second uniqueness theorem states that if we have a volume V filled with a charge density rho and surrounded by conducting boundaries, the electric field inside the region is uniquely determined if we specify the total charges that sit on the conductors at the boundary. There are two things to notice here. First, we talk about the possibility of having several boundaries. So obviously we have an outer boundary, but there can also be some regions inside V where we have a conducting surface. There doesn't have to be these additional regions, but it's possible. And second, these conducting surfaces have some kind of complicated charge distribution on them. But the theorem tells us that we do not care about the exact charge distribution on the conductors. We're only interested in the total charge on them. Let's prove the theorem. We start by assuming that there are two different electric fields allowed in our volume. Each one fulfills the first Maxwell equation, and at each boundary, the integral version of the first Maxwell equation is fulfilled, where Q is the total charge on the conductor. Now we define, again, a third field, E3, which fulfills homogeneous versions of the two equations discussed earlier. A nice trick to prove this theorem is to look at the divergence of the electrostatic potential phi3 times the electric field E3. After using the product rule, we get two terms. One of them vanishes because of the first equation earlier. For the other term, we can replace the gradient of phi with a negative electric field. So this expression is equal to minus E3 squared. Next, we apply the divergence theorem in order to change from a volume integral to a surface integral on the left-hand side of the equation. These are actually several separate surface integrals depending on how many boundaries we have. At this point, we can think about this phi3 a bit more. The electrostatic potential on the surface of any conductor is constant. Conductors are so-called equipotentials. This means we can write the phi3 outside of the integral. For the outer boundary, we assume that the electrostatic potential is zero, which is usually the case. But now the left-hand side is zero because of the second equation for E3. What does this mean? The integral over E3 squared is zero. A squared quantity cannot be negative, so the only way that adding pieces of E3 squared leads to zero is that E3 itself is zero everywhere. And this finally means that E1 and E2 are exactly the same. The electric field in this region is unique. And that's pretty much it for this video. Thanks for watching.